It is on the work of all of you that I claim to be the chairman of this institution. It is better that I am from Chennai rather than intruding into the good work that you are doing. So I watch it with pride and happiness from a very distant place. So this is a topic which in a way is a continuation of the discussions we had for almost 2 hours just now. Professor Roger Moser, who's a professor from, actually a professor with a business background, a technocrat, who says India is his second home. He was partnering me in the discussions today on developing how to employ technology which is already developed, rather than developing new technology. This is a new area of development all over the world. And when he started his presentation, even before he went into the subject, he said, India must be more self-confident. That a person who is a foreigner, who has made India a second home, his first observation is that Indians must be more self-confident and India must be more self-confident. The necessity for this, the necessity for reiterating and recalling what Mr. Moser said, will be to see that that runs through my presentation, including how we are handling the current problems. Unless we understand where we are from and what are the problems and where the problems are coming, we will not be able to have clear intellectual solutions for the problems. This is the basis on which I am recalling Dr. Moser's statement. You see, India is a country with thousands of years of continuity. No other country has this continuity. Geography has existed, but culture has not existed. As Swami Vivekananda said, spider weaves its web where the Caesars ruled. The stones are there, the buildings are there, the pyramids are there, but the thoughts and the culture, the way of life and the language and the literature, what bound the people at that time is no more there, but we have still. He said if Vedavyasa came back to India, he will find some of the traffic landmarks identified even today. And that is the kind of change with continuity that this country has been able to adapt itself. And that is why it is a living civilization. So we have seen so many things happening. And we had to talk about recent things, colonization, then capitalism, then socialism, then globalization. But I have been having a helicopter look at the shelf life of all these ideas. Colonization lasted for 200 years. Now it is abused as one of the worst happenings in the history of the world. But it dominated the world. It dominated our minds. It left its imprint. Even today, we suffer from the hangovers of colonization. The colonizers feel guilty about colonization, but the colonized people are not feeling sad that they were colonized, and they continue to revel in the things that colonizers left. It's a very paradoxical phenomenon, but the fact is, colonization exhausted itself in 200 years. Capitalism came. It exhausted itself in 100 years. Then came socialism. It became irrelevant in 50 years. Then came globalization, which is now irrelevant in 25 years. You can understand the shelf life of ideas which became so fashionable, so powerful, with so much drive, with an obsessive instinct, it becomes irrelevant in such a short time. But we are gripped by that thinking, we are gripped by the impact that it makes on us, and it leaves us completely confounded about what we are, who we are. In fact, at a time when globalization was hitting India like a tsunami, and people like us who protested, I still recall in the Administrative Staff College of India when I was addressing in Hyderabad, one retired ex-serviceman stood up and said, people like you should be shot dead because you are preventing the growth and the development of India by opposing globalization. You can't differ from the mainline thought. That is the power of modernity. Modernity makes itself so all-powerful that anyone who deviates from that has no right to live. You know, that is the kind of imposition that it brings about. And so I want to take all of you to another level and think how India should look at itself, and then economics will follow. Without this understanding, what kind of economics, what is the state of the Indian economy, and what are its solutions, we can never be able to understand unless we understand how the Indian mind has been shaped, the policy making, intellectual, powerful, ruling, media mind has been shaped over the last 100 years perhaps. You know, in 1853, Karl Marx wrote a couple of articles in New York Herald Tribune in which he said that India is a very peculiar country. At that time, no one doubted the unity of India. Afterwards, only the Marxists began saying, no, it is a geographical construct. Even Karl Marx said India was a nation. And it had one way of life, it had one kind of rule, though it had several rulers. And though it had one way of life, one identity, its economics was organized in terms of villages. And for 2000 years, this country has not changed, its economy has not changed, but between the producer and the consumer, there is such an intimacy that there was very little of exploitation. But the only wrong thing with Indians is that they were worshipping cows and monkey. That was his objection. That you were worshipping cows and monkey, he regarded you as a semi-barbaric society. And so this society must be demolished and its economic base must collapse so that you are prepared for revolution, because without revolution you cannot modernize. And Indian society will never modernize because it is steeped in continuity. And so he said what the British are doing is right by destroying the society, and it is a welcome destruction. He said, though it is painful, it is pleasurable also. Then came Max Weber. Max Weber was the only brain in the world who linked philosophy, living style, society, collectivism to economic growth. No other thinker ever did this. All others subsequently moved away from this vision. Max Weber said he looked at the Protestant societies and said, Protestant societies move faster because there is individualism. Because of individualism, there is enterprise. Because of enterprise, there is entrepreneurship. Because of entrepreneurship, there is economic development. And so modern economic model will align with Protestantism, and Catholic societies will not be able to catch up with Protestant societies. And he was absolutely right, because America, Canada, New Zealand, England, Australia, they were all moving fast. But if you look at France, OECD countries constituted a study, Development Studies Institute, in which Angus Madison, after 18 years of research, came out with his magnum opus, World Economic History, a Millennial Perspective, in which he said for the 1500 years, India was the leading economic engine of the world. In the 16th century, India and China became equal. And 17th century, India overtook China again. 18th century and 19th century, both were overtaken by others. Imagine if this research was available. Would Karl Marx have written like that? Max Weber, could he have written like that? But there are admitted research studies which show it is these two great men who influenced the Indian academia, Indian education system, Indian public discourse, Indian policy making. So we decided that we cannot generate our own ideas. We have to import ideas. It is not just importing goods. Importing goods can be stopped. Once you start importing ideas, it can never be stopped. This is where the Indians were caught in a catch-22 situation of being one of the largest societies. 1/6 of humanity is India. But we did not develop the faculty of our own thinking, and that is where we as a nation suffer today. In terms of policy making on specifics also, which I will come to later, but I wanted to give this background without which we cannot understand why we are in this mess. Otherwise, you will be only saying we are in a mess. Why? What causes? Where our thought pattern has been interfered with by so powerfully that even to think differently, we need to look at here and there whether I will be misunderstood if I think differently is the kind of lack of confidence into which Indians have fallen, from which we have to recover. And how the world is now doing, if you look at the world, you see, you had two opposite parallels of Marxism and capitalism, which ruled the world for 25, 30 years. And you know, communism collapsed. And so the global order was seen as only based on free market and liberal democracy. Francis Fukuyama even wrote a book, The End of History and the Last Man, in which he said that these two institutions have established themselves as the final victor for the rest over the West, the West over the rest. And it is best for the rest to follow the West. And this was the theory that was expounded. It became the Bible of globalization. And we were mandated into globalization because of our own wrong policies which we followed for 25 years in the name of command economy, which destroyed the Indian enterprise. The Indian enterprise dominated the world. If you look at the literature available in Greco-Roman literature, in Roman parliament this was discussed, that Indian traders are looting the Roman Empire. All our gold is disappearing. There are at least 300 ships of Indians which are floating around our waters, carrying goods from India and carrying nothing from here back. You know, this was the kind of economic impact we had over the world. But colonization, capitalism, communism, globalization in succession made us feel that we cannot do anything. We have to really wait for others to tell us what we should do. And that is how we accepted globalization. And Francis Fukuyama, who wrote the book End of History and Last Man, he wrote another book in the year 1994, in which he said, the family-based societies are different from individualism-based societies. This is the book he wrote on the basis of extensive research material as to how Asia is different, because China was rising at that time. Japan had already risen by that time. Korea and Taiwan had risen. And he said that individualism-based societies are losing out and family-based societies are rising. And the Economist magazine commented, this man wrote a book, End of History, and he is now talking about End of Economics. You understand this? If you write about the success of family-based societies in economics, you are talking about the end of economics. So this is where globalization began as the all-pervasive and the dominant idea. And India, if it has to develop, it has to go only through the route of globalization, that it cannot even make a local variation of it. And this was the thought against which we fought throughout the last 25 years. And that gave me enough experience to understand what India is really. And that is what I will share with you to an extent. Now, what is happening to the idea of globalization? All of you know that President Trump came to power in America. And many of us have not followed very minutely What was the discourse in America and the world when Trump was contesting the elections? When Trump had become a candidate, then Larry Summers, who was the economic advisor to Clinton's and also the Treasury Secretary, he said he would cause a market crash and throw the world into recession. The election is going to take place in November, December. And this man says in June, and afterwards, Citigroup said Trump victory would mean global recession. And his first gift would be another financial crisis. Washington Post, a President Trump could destroy the world economy. Then Ratner and former chief of IMF, protracted recession for 18 months from which the world cannot recover. And after the election had taken place and there was a prognosis that Trump may win, the Paul Krugman, the Nobel laureate, said, probably global recession with no end in sight. And after Trump had won, the UK Independent magazine wrote, Trump's first gift to the world, another catastrophic financial crisis. These are all great experts whom the world trusted, knowledge people, economists, with a tremendous amount of research and data backing them, experience. You know what happens after Trump came to power? In the first month, in 1 month, the dollar index rose by 5.6%, the highest in 14 years. He shook America and the world. You know, before that, what he did? Third day, he terminated the Transatlantic, Trans-Pacific Partnership, TPP, of 12 nations. The third day. Seventh day, he said, these people should not have sent refugees into America. And then in June, he withdrew from the climate accord. Shook the world. Climate is such an important thing. He said, hell with it. I have to make America strong. The country which drove the very process of globalization and said, no one's interest is important, the collective interest of all is important. These are the rules. Whether they complied with it or not is a different thing. And that country said, my interest is important. It is not globalism, it is Americanism which is important. We have to factor this in. If we have to decide what we have to do, then he took on all traditional allies, European Union, Canada, these are all traditional allies of America. And he began holding Russian hands and said Russia should be brought back into G8, which was removed because of it occupied Crimea. You know, this he began shaking the world. Many people began calling him almost a madman, but he was working to a plan. He was correcting the distortions for America, whether you like it or not. He is an American, he is an American president, he is elected by Americans. And so he was correcting the distortions, and I'm not going to go into the list of all that he did and shook the world and its allies and see the results he produced. The dollar index rose up by 5.6%. The stocks rose by 38% in 22 months. A historic rate of return for America by any standards. And 75 million Americans became rich. Tax savers became rich because of that. He promised against all these prognoses that if this man came, America will collapse, the world will collapse. He said, I will give you 3.5% GDP growth. People said, he's really mad. When the whole expertise of the world is converging to so he is going to destroy the American and the global economy, this man is saying he will give 3.5% growth rate. You know what he did? In the first quarter when he took over as president, you leave it. The next two quarters, he achieved a growth rate of 3.1%. In the second quarter of 2018, he achieved 4.2%. In the third quarter of 2018, just now it ended, 3.5%. He stopped the experts from commenting on his policies. And yes, he is creating 223,000 jobs per month. And the unemployment rate has come down to 3.8%, which is 18-year low. Why I am mentioning this is, the entire expertise of the world failed against the policy making by Trump. Has it ever been discussed in the Indian media? We all abuse Trump like the American media abuses Trump. Can you believe the entire American media converged on a particular day to write the same editorial in all the newspapers? I have never seen newspapers behaving in such a converged manner against an individual. But we also joined the chorus without understanding what is happening, what Trump is doing to America, how it is going to affect the world, how it is going to affect us, is a more important discourse in which we should be engaging than whether Trump is right or not in America. And our people began writing editorials, articles, discourses, and we were conducting discussions in television whether Trump is right in America or not. Why I am saying this is a completely misdirected discourse of a slavish nation. That is why when Mr. Moser said that Indians have to grow self-confident, is that we should know how we should participate in this discourse first. We never even know that we can differ from the Financial Times, that we can protest against what is written in Wall Street Journal. We can say what Washington Post says is wrong. We cannot say that because you don't have the self-confidence. So Trump had the courage to say that. Trump said, you Washington Post is wrong, you Wall Street Journal is wrong. That is where Trump established that a determined leader can make the economic thinkers wrong. There are two situations in which economics and economists have let down the world and let down the subject also. In the year 2008, all the economists were saying hunky-dory, everything is good. Alan Greenspan even wrote a book in the year 2007 that everything is hunky-dory. And you know what happened in 2008? Afterwards, there was a catastrophic collapse. And the Economist magazine, which speaks for the experts, economic experts of the world, and the current economic theories, it wrote a cover story, economic theory has melted away, and the economic, arrogant economic profession has been beaten to shyness and shame. Why I am mentioning this is, the same thing has been repeated when all these experts said Trump will fail. He will not only fail America, he will ensure the failure of the world. He has been able to lift up America, and that is why even the global economy has began doing well. And so he hit China in a big way. You know, no American president had the guts to do anything against China. But he stood up against China. China is now running for cover. China said, no, we have $1.8 trillion investment in your treasury securities. He said, sell it. Who are you going to sell it to? Who is going to buy? Please understand, if you invest in a wrong company, it is not that that company benefits, that you are also in trouble. America has sold its securities to the world to the extent of $11 trillion. And everybody is saddled with these securities, including Japan. We, $150 billion of Indian money is invested in dollars. So, dollarization of the world is something on which the entire world has to think, but we are not thinking. How to get out of this? We have a way. I'm going to tell you that. We have already started doing it. But there is no discourse. When the government does it, at least you are doing something good, not a single editorial. Not a single news item. And one great change has taken place in the world economy, which is so open before our eyes, but there is not a single word written in the Indian media about it. You know, whenever the petrol price used to go up, energy prices, crude prices, dollar value used to come down. This has been some kind of a protection for the rest of the nations. When the oil prices go up, the dollar value will come down. That will partly compensate for the local oil prices. But this has stopped from 2015. You know why? America allowed American oil companies to export oil. Because they began producing enough oil, their imports came down by 23% in 2016. And they began exporting oil, with the result America had no more any trouble from the rise in price of crude. This is a complete shift from 1950s, whenever America had feared the rise in petrol prices. It always feared the fall in the value of the dollar. Now the negative correlation between dollar and oil has become a positive correlation between the two. Actually, an American academic had come when I discussed this subject. Sir, even some of us had not thought of it. I said, we are thinking of it because we are suffering from it. So in the last 3 years, you find not only the crude price is going up, dollar value is also going up, a double whammy for oil importing nations which are dollarized in their economy. And this has enabled Trump to take a strong arm action against Iran. Because America is one of the top three oil producers, and say they are the largest oil producer this year. And Trump could take a strong arm action against Iran, and he is not bothered about the rise in oil prices because of the shift in the correlation between oil and dollar, a subject which has been completely ignored in the Indian discourse. We are only saying petrol prices gone up, Modi is wrong. Our idea is how to find fault with the government. Our idea is not about the cause. Our idea is not economics. Our idea is politics. So because of that, there is no discourse in India. It's only whether you are responsible or somebody else is responsible. And a 30-year settled relationship between China and America has been completely broken and reversed. And China is now running for cover. A country which was feared by the Americans, both in political terms, in military terms, in economic terms, without China, what we will do? How we will maintain our price levels? How will we maintain our standard of living? And it had become the factory for America, for the world, in fact. They produce 100 units and consume only 46 units. Balance 54 units they export. They are over-dependent on globalization. And they trusted globalization to continue with the result that they trusted the WTO is going to be there, the trade preferences are going to be there, but they never expected somebody like Trump to come. And Trump is doing one thing more. Apart from the fact that he has made these economies irrelevant, I want to make one more point for economists who are here, because I'm also struggling with this idea. There is no functioning universal economic theory today. I will make only 2 points. One is that America has been incurring current account deficits from 1976 till today. They have incurred about $11 trillion current account deficit. Any other country incurring this account of current account deficit, economic theory says the value of that currency should go down so that this trend will reverse. They will begin exporting and rather than importing. This is normal economic theory. But instead of the dollar value going down in this period, the dollar value appreciated by 330% in this period, completely giving a lie to the theory of economics. Second thing, America printed in the last 5 years, 6 years, 2008 to 2014, $4.5 trillion. Actually, printed means they issued digital currency. By this digital currency, they saved the local economy, they funded the global economy, and no one said US Federal Reserve System was wrong in doing it. But if any other country had done it, they would say you will die of inflation. And we have given up the right to print our own currency, you know it, in the year 2002, by a law called the FRBM law. The government of India has given up the right to print the Indian rupee. If only the Indian rupee gets expanded, you know why? When dollar comes into India and the Reserve Bank acquires the dollar, it prints Indian rupees and gives it to the banking system. There is no other way the Indian rupee gets generated today. If the dollar inflow is there, the Indian rupee supply will increase. If $30 billion go out of India, then to that extent the Indian rupee will supply will be withdrawn. Has anyone evaluated the economic consequences of it? We have given up our right to print. That is, the government of India cannot borrow from the Reserve Bank of India by filing its securities. That the government of India should not borrow excessively is understandable. But it should not borrow is not understandable. We pleaded to the government of India, they constituted a committee in the year 2015 to amend the FRBM law, which was passed at a time in 2002 when the whole world thought that there should be no printing of currencies, it will all be taken care of by banks and the market. That has become an outdated economics because Americans themselves have printed $4.5 trillion. Japanese began printing $40 billion every month from October 2015. Today they have increased the size of the printing to $70 billion per month. Have we ever discussed this in the context of India? It is not necessary that if they print, we should print. That if we need, can we print today? There is liquidity problem. Can the government of India say, I will give you 100,000 crores worth of government securities. You give me the cash. The government of India cannot do it because it has passed a law giving up that power. These are all issues which need to be discussed. But our economic theoreticians will say, no. Printing of currencies is wrong. You cannot give it to the politicians. It has to be only the central government, the Reserve Bank. How the Reserve Bank will print currency? Only if the dollar comes in. Can you have a national economics based on the inflow of foreign exchange? These are all issues which will decide the state of the economy in India and the solutions which we need to find. Another big change that has taken place is that this much adumbrated globalization, which came with a tsunami-like impact and made such a powerful impact on our policymakers, on the media, on our intellectuals, that has been reversed by Trump. Trump is very clear. We are no more for globalism. We are for Americanism. He expressly says so. Another thing which he has done, which constitutes a completely reverse position taken by Japan and America, is Japan, America printed $4.5 trillion till about 4 months back. Now America, Trump has decided we will not print the dollar anymore. We will withdraw the dollar from circulation. $40 billion every month he has begun withdrawing from circulation from October 2018. On the one hand, the dollar is needed more and more. America is withdrawing dollar from circulation so that the dollar value will go up. America is happy about the rise in the dollar value. But the Indian economists are thinking lower Indian rupee value is good for economics because exporters will benefit. You can understand the dollar value was 45, now it is 70. I don't think exports have picked up to the extent of the fall in the dollar value, but the economists continue to insist a lower rupee value because that is a philosophy for us. That's an ideology. American dollar value will go up. Because of that, imports into America will become cheaper. So Trump has a solution for that. Levy import duty on imports which are coming in so that the goods will not be cheaper. And now if everything goes in Trump's way, he is going to impose 25% duties from January on $500 billion imports of China. Afterwards, what will happen to China? No one knows. Because China has established factories for America. And the foundation of globalization has been shaken. Multilateralism has been completely delegitimized. Unilateralism has become, if Trump does it, every country will do it. Trump has unilaterally imposed duties on aluminium imports and steel imports from European Union, from Canada. You may find fault with Trump. But Trump has given such growth to America. Whether Trump is there or not after 2020, the Trump policies can never be given up by Americans. Any president who comes will find it difficult not to follow the policies, because if the consequences are difficult, then he will have to take responsibility. So the Trump phenomenon will last beyond Trump. Is there any Indian discourse on this point? Have you ever read an article like this? Any economist speaking like this? Any of the pink newspapers discussing this subject? So there is a complete failure of economic intellectualism in India. And as I said, there are two kinds of polarized economics. America withdrawing dollar, Japan printing dollar, printing yen. America is raising interest rates. Japan is working on negative interest rates. For example, in Japan, negative interest rate means that if you have 5,000 rupees, you want to deposit with the bank. The next year, the bank will give you only 4,900 in return, because 100 rupees they will keep to keep your money. This is negative interest. So people are forced to spend, but people are not spending. Because in a family-based society, people don't spend because the government wants them to spend. In America, people spend. It is based on debit cards. Japan runs on credit cards. Japan runs on debit cards. These are culturally different situations. So we have a world monetary order in which one country is printing its currencies and distributing it free. They are investing 5 lakh crores in our high-speed railway at 1.1% interest for the next 50 years because they print the money. On the other hand, you have America withdrawing the dollar, raising the interest rates, and the IMF and the World Bank can't do anything about it. They are a complete failure. They are onlookers today. They are only rushing to the help of countries which are in distress. They have become distress lending institutions. They are no more World Monetary Authority. We must understand that IMF is constituted to find a common currency for the world. It failed in its main objective. Dollar became the main currency. First it was backed by gold. Afterwards it was backed by the necessity to have a common currency to trade between anybody and anybody. So dollar became a necessity, and that necessity became the strength of the dollar. And that country which held the responsibility for the world in whichever measure, in whatever efficiency, it is withdrawing from its central position. And what is the impact of it for the world and for India? That is a matter in which we need to have an extensive discussions. And over and above that, the money that you talk about is real money, that you are earning money, putting it in stock, putting it in real estate, putting it in gold, putting it in banks. This is real money. But the value of this money is not decided by any real money. The value of this is decided by phony money. The phony money circulation, you will be amazed to know, which brought about the downfall of the world economy in 2005. The phony money, the real money in 2010 was $6 trillion, the printed money. The phony money was $600 trillion. This is money built on money, which had no relevance to the real economy. The world GDP today is $90 trillion. The phony money is $900 trillion. This is generated by the financial system. And that will invest in a country and withdraw the money. And this is not real money. But that will decide the fate of the nations. And how are we going to adjust to a system in which there is no, and now cryptocurrencies have come. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the idea of cryptocurrency. Even the best experts will not be able to explain. All that I can say, it is like a private currency. There are at least some 900 private currencies which are going on. In Japan itself, there are about 100 private currencies. You can create a private currency and circulate it amongst yourself. But this private currency is based on actual trade. There is a group of people admitted into a club. And they begin actually buying stocks, they begin investing money, they begin trading. This is all going through a supercomputer. And the demand and supply based on actual transactions will decide the price. And this has become a cryptocurrency over which nobody has any control. And there is an attempt to get it regularized in India. A case is going on in court. So the issue is very complex, very difficult, and the geopolitics has never been so complex as it is today. There is nothing like anybody is anybody's friend. Trump is fighting with his own tested friends, European Union, Canada. He is calling Canadian Prime Minister as a liar. So you can understand the instability that has been caused in what are known as the Western Bloc. And China-US relationship, you know what it is. US-Russia are friends in one place and they are fighting in another place. Europe says it will have its own army, and there is NATO, which is American army, and they may have their own army, but they will need NATO also. This kind of complex situation has never been witnessed after the Second World War. In this situation, how we handle our economics? The impact of Trump on the world, on US and the world, as I said, will last beyond Trump. This assumption we have to make. Second, globalization is now a matter of the past. WTO is in ICU. Nobody even talks about WTO. Have you ever heard of WTO in newspapers in recent times? But these were all the obsession with us 15 years back, 20 years back. The shelf life of all these newly created institutions which are fashionable at a particular time lose their relevance because they are not founded on firm foundations of collective behavior. You cannot have a ruling elite saying that we will have globalization from today onwards without the people wanting globalization. Even the American people did not want globalization. That Trump has found out. Geopolitically influenced global economics will be the future. This 2+2 model which we are talking about, in which VIF is engaged in a big way. It is not only about economics. We will also talk about security. It will not be only the finance secretary, the defense secretary will also be in the discussions. What does that mean? We are not going to build economic alliances, we are going to build security alliances, civilizational alliances, social alliances, political alliances. This was unheard of 10 years back, 5 years back. A new model of international relationships is developing. Nothing will be, in India you will be only talking about NPA, you will be only talking about recapitalization of banks. There is no towering thinking mind in the system, in outside. Everybody is looking through their particular window. But the nation doesn't consist of 10 windows. It consists of one building. So we need to have a very comprehensive thinking model in which I pleaded in the previous session that Vivekananda International Foundation should take a lead because Delhi is the heart of India, but it is not a place where the thought of India is being generated, and so we need to do this. It's a huge impact on China. What will happen to China? Certainly China does not know. I don't think anyone else also knows. Having established the factory for the world and invested trillions and trillions of dollars in roads and railways and roads, you know, there is a time when Japan used to build roads which they will not use, build airports which they will not use. Why they build? Only to give employment to the people. You know, that is the kind of economics that Japan followed at one point, which economics China began following later, expecting the airports and the 8-lane roads to be used in future. But there is no future. So there is a kind of total chaotic situation in the monetary, trade, economic and political relationship in the world. I am not sounding pessimistic. You have to understand all this, because India is too big a country to be pushed over today. There was a time which India could be pushed over, but fortunately there is some awakening in India. We have gained strength, we are militarily strong, we are an atomic power, and we cannot be pushed over because all other countries think India cannot be pushed over. Whether Indians think or not is irrelevant, because the rest of the world thinks that we cannot push over India. And the Indian passport has become a respectable document today, for which the Indian media or Indian intellectual or Indian policymakers have done nothing. The world has recognized the worth of India. So now, how do we come to grips with our situation? What is the current? There is an unstable world. How do we handle our situation? I will take you back to the three blocks of periods: 1999 to 2004, 2004 to 2014, and 2015 onwards. Unless we have this background, the state of the current state of the Indian economy cannot be understood, nor the solutions for this we will be able to grasp. I am giving you some figures of 1999 to 2004 and 2004 to 2010, which is supposed to be the best year of India. 9.8% GDP growth, and our foreign exchange reserves had shot up from $140 billion to $310 billion. So this is supposed to be the golden period of the Indian economy. I will give you the figures to find out how golden it is. In 1999 to 2004, the GDP growth was 5.4%. In 2004-10, 9.8%, almost double. Prices, 4.8% in 1999, 6.8% in the next 6 years. Stock prices rose by 32% in 5 years, 1999 to 2004. 311% in the next 6 years. Gold prices, 38% in the first 5 years, 320% in the next 6 years. Land, 21% in the first 5 years, 200 to 2100% in the next 6 years. Jobs generated, 60 million in the first 5 years, 2.7 million in the next 6 years. This is a period of destruction of the Indian economy. Not the growth of the Indian economy. You know, in this period what happened, which I tried to explain to the authorities, you will be amazed to know that in this period the foreign exchange went up from 140 billion to 310 billion and that transformed into rupees. The banks were saddled with money. At that time, Dr. Y.V. Reddy said, don't allow this money to come in, because you will not know how to use it. And he wanted that taxed. But the finance minister said, the whole world wants to put money in India. Why are you spoiling it? This money came into the stock market. transformed into rupees, became bank deposits. If the bank said this kind of deposit, what will the bank do? It has to lend, but there is no borrower. You know what the government of India did? It brought down the import duty of capital goods to zero and made the banks lend, with the result the bank deposits went up from 12% to 20%, credit went up from 15% to 27%, and we imported capital goods which we did not need, and all this money went to China. We had a trade deficit of $175 billion with China in 14 years, which is equal to 3 times China's defense expenditure and 5 times India's defense expenditure. And this is because we allowed the money that came in, which we did not need, and afterwards it got converted into rupees, and we did not know how to use it, and the banks were asked to lend it, and for which customs duties were brought down, and that money is the NPA today. I challenge anybody in the media or any one of the economists to deny this fact. That is the NPA today. Raghuram Rajan admitted this part. Yes, excessive lending took place at that time and that became bad debt. Why the excessive lending took place? The Reserve Bank of India at that time, headed by one of the topmost macro economists, Y.V. Reddy, he was called by the US Federal Reserve System and he addressed all the governors. And the US Federal Reserve System said, if Y.V. Reddy had been the chairman of the US Federal Reserve System, world economic meltdown would not have taken place. He gave the advice, stop this money from coming in. Our government did not follow the advice. The money which you did not came in and became your problem. And that became your NPA today. And this government began grappling with it. And the unprovided NPA, and you know, in this period, the revenue deficit went up by 16 lakh crores in 5 years. And tax cuts were 3 lakh crores per year. So these 3 lakh crores tax cuts was given to spend the foreign exchange that we received. And if you look at the, somebody mentioned that oil is the biggest problem of India. No. In the 10-year period, UPA period, oil imports were $515 billion. Capital goods imports were $585 billion. Whereas in the NDA period, capital goods import was just $10 billion. And for the first time only in the NDA period, for 2 years, we had current account surplus of $25 billion. That is why India was seen as a rising power at that time. Everything was reversed because we were getting the free flow of money, this phony money, unbacked by savings, production, investment, that came into India. We received it, cooked up our economy, turned it into NPA, and saddled it on this government. The only fault of this government is that it did not come out with a white paper saying, this is what happened. Now, two problems. I told you how the asset prices went up by 10 times, 15 times. How did these asset prices rise? It was because of the high denomination currencies which were printed. In just 18 months prior to demonetization, the 500 rupee, 1000 rupee notes rise was 4.8 lakh crores. That is what funded this gold and real estate prices. And if it had gone on the same way, 2008, what happened in America by the subprime lending would have taken place because of high denomination currency in India. If anybody wants to have a debate with me, I will be able to prove that but for demonetization, the Indian economy would have collapsed. It was a corrective. But in India, there is no economic discourse. It's only political discourse. That is one corrective, a huge shock. I tell you, the people of this nation should be congratulated. 50 crore people stood in queue to collect 2,000 and 3,000 and 5,000 because they put faith in the government that it is doing the right thing. No commentator, no economist, no media would welcome this. They all said there will be riots. Even the Supreme Court said there will be riots. People were not rioting. It was such a disappointment for these people that people who stood in the queue, they were not, so many people died of heart attack. Still the people are not rioting. Can you believe how the people are and how the discourse is? Then came the GST. Two powerful, one is corrective and another is reformative. I don't think any other government would have taken this measure. There is no reasoned appraisal of the government actions. It's all fault finding. Of course you can find faults. In politics you find faults. But experts don't do it. Media should not do it. Intellectuals should not do it. Opposition parties can do it. It is their duty to say wrong even when there is nothing. I can understand. But what about the media? What about the intellectuals? What about the economists? The economists in India, the intellectuals in India, the media in India are doing, have done, and will continue to do what the media, experts, business in America did when Trump was coming to power. Trump only disproved all of these people, as I told you. So what we have to understand, that we are a bank-driven economy. We are not a market-driven economy. In America, 75% of the money comes from stock market. In India, only 3% of the Indian savings goes into stock market. But don't think we are only fools. Even Japanese are fools. They invest only 9% of their savings in stocks. 51% of the Japanese savings are held in bank deposits. You know what is the rate of interest on bank deposits? For short-term deposit, the depositor has to give money for the bank to keep money. Negative rate of interest. For long-term deposit of 5 years, 0.8% is the rate of interest on deposit, but still 51% of the Japanese savings are invested in bank deposits. The most modern instruments are traded in the Japanese stock market, but the Japanese do not trade in them. It is only the foreigners who trade in them. This is the character of a family-based society. So India, banks are the lifeline. But the Indian policy making on the bank is based on the American model, in which stock market is the prime mover, bank is the subordinate player. But in India, bank is the main player. So in a bank-driven economy, if you restrict the banks, you are restricting the economy. You are restricting the flow of funds into the economy. Now, how we follow the banking model of the world? You know, there are certain norms prescribed for banks, that you must have so much capital. But the Basel institution, which created this model, laid down rules that for commercial banks only what we say will apply, and only for internationally active banks what we say will apply. But banks which are not internationally active need not conform to what we say. The universal banks need not conform to what they say. We don't have any commercial banks, we have only universal banks. Because our banks do term lending, we do all kinds of activities. But still, the same Basel norms are imposed. You look at Japan. In Japan, there are internationally active banks and there are domestic banks. For the internationally active banks, the capital norm is 8%. For domestic banks, 4%. In India, for both, it is 9%. I do don't know where this 9% was got up by the regulator. It is 9%. With the result, we are doing more than what the Basel wants. And so the banks have let less money to lend. These are all things on which there is no discourse in India. Why should we? On the scale of Japan, there are only 4 internationally active banks in India. All others are domestic banks. They need not have 8% capital, but they are also forced into having not only 8% capital, they are forced into having 9% capital, because some people think the IMF feels happy if we have 9% capital. Can you believe this? Policymakers telling this to me. You know, we create problems for ourselves. Where problems do not exist, you create. And you are praised for that all over the world. Financial Times will write an article how great an institution you are, how independent you are. So we are now guided by the same thought. We are not independent. You know, a saint in Kanchipuram who guided my life, he issued a statement on the 15th of August 1947. It is such a fantastic and far-reaching statement. He said, we have become free. Now we can become independent. We became free. We have not yet become independent. And with the result that we do not have any original thinking even today. For example, this government has taken a far-reaching original step by a $75 billion swap with Japan. Nobody has even understood what it is. You know what? Dollar-rupee relationship is working against rupee for the last several decades. Now we are moving towards yen. That is what this swap means. We are having $147 billion of our foreign exchange in terms of dollars. The rest in terms of other currencies. Now, the government is probably well advised and is thinking that we should move more towards yen, because yen has a natural hedge against dollar, because it is running a current account surplus with America and it has $1 trillion investment in American securities. So we have a natural hedge. So our natural partner must be Japan. Financial partner, investment partner, trade partner. But our mind is, who could it do? America. I'm not saying America is wrong, but it is not appropriate for us. That we should think of an alternative umbrella, we will not think of. So even if a solution is available, your mind is blocking it. So we have to rework our relationship. In fact, America is necessary for us. It is necessary for many geopolitical purposes. But it is not necessary that we should have this kind of dollarized integration with them, which is not necessary. Even America will not mind it. But you think you should not do it. Why? Because you are not free enough to think. You are not a free thinker. As I said, we have been following an utterly wrong import policy of having capital goods import exceeding oil imports. We need to go in for heavy import restriction. We have got to cut down the current account deficit and trade deficit in the next 1 year. Otherwise, we will continue to accentuate this problem, on which all the institutions will have to work together. And if an import restriction is made, the media will say India is moving away from free trade, as if everybody is following free trade and India is moving away from free trade, because your newspapers have nothing to do with the reality. They are not understanding any of the implications of what's happening in the world. So, as I said, the FRBM law has to be amended. And we have to align our NPA rules to the Basel norms and no more. And this should be looked upon as a bank-driven economy. And what India lacks today is credit for MSME sector. Without understanding the MSME sector, we will not be able to understand the Indian economy. You know, we all look at the stock market and say, stock market is 38,000, India is on top of the world. All the listed companies put together contribute to only 5% of India's GDP, just 5%. The entire corporate sector, listed and unlisted put together, constitute only 15% of India's GDP. And it is the non-corporate sector, it is the MSME sector, which contributes to 50% of India's GDP and 90% of India's employment. And the economic census 2014 says that the number of people employed in these non-farming enterprises, one-account enterprises, is 128 million. Whereas the entire corporate sector, public and private, government, put together employs only 12.8 million people. It is this sector which has been hit by both demonetization as well as GST. It is this sector that has been robbed of the credit. In any other country, this would have collapsed. They are surviving only because of community support, but they cannot survive for long. That is one of the issues on which the media is supposed to highlight. But if the government says that this sector should be funded, the media says the government is now working against the independence of the Reserve Bank. Can you follow the distortion in the thinking of India? So, a sector which is driving India, is the lifeline of India, which constitutes 70% of the exports of India, 90% of the employment of India, 50% of the GDP of India, that is starved of money. These are the issues. Once this money is released, the growth rate will pick up, consumption will pick up, savings will pick up, investment will pick up, because it will be bottom upwards driven economy. And it will not be just a top-down economy like the stock market coming and flooding the economy around, which it did in 2004 to 2010. A new thinking is needed, an India-centric thinking is needed. We should not be ideological in this thinking. We have to be rooted in the ground. And with this appeal, I think all of us should ensure that a proper discourse takes place in Delhi, because this is where action is, and thank you very much.